In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us take a moment for silent reflection and self-examination. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins, as a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ. And by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer, for you alone are the Holy Alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
Let us pray together the prayer of the day. O God, you show forth your almighty power chiefly by reaching out to us in mercy. Grant us the fullness of your grace Strengthen our trust in your promises and bring all the world to share in the treasures that come through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first lesson comes from the book of Revelation, chapter 7, beginning with verse 9. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hand, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and around the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. And therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. Never again will they hunger, never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Here ends the reading. Our psalm for today comes from Psalm 149. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of his faithful people. Let Israel rejoice in their Maker. Let the people of Zion be glad in their King. Let them praise his name with dancing and make music to him with timbrel and harp. For the Lord takes delight in his people. He crowns the humble with victory. Let his faithful people rejoice in this honor and sing for joy on their beds. May the praise of God be in their mouths and a double-edged sword in their hands, to inflict vengeance on the nations and punishment on the peoples, to bind their kings with fetters, their nobles with shackles of iron, to carry out the sentence written against them. This is the glory of all his faithful people. Praise the Lord. Our second lesson for today comes from the book of 1 John, chapter 3, beginning with verse 1. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Here ends the reading.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 5. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the word of the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Well, in the church calendar, this is called All Saints Sunday, and we think of different things when we think of saints. I suppose we all think of Saint Peter, of course, one of the apostles of Jesus. Well, maybe we think of some names of churches like Saint Matthew's and Saint Mark's and Saint Luke's and Saint John's and maybe even Saint Olaf's. Well, anyway, that being said, I greet you this morning with a greeting you rarely probably hear. Are you ready? It is, Good morning, saints. Good morning, saints. And we're going to talk about saints today, according to the scriptures and the church calendar. Again, this is All Saints Sunday, the Sunday after the Reformation that we celebrated last week. And we remember and we honor Christian saints today. Well, who are these Christian saints, you may ask? We may think of, as we think of that word saint, we may think of the apostles of Jesus or early Christian leaders, people of faith, sometimes thinking of the Old Testament giants of the faith that we read about, and we'll mention some of those today. Or we perhaps even think about those who recently have died and gone on to their heavenly reward. Well, that all being said, according to the Word of God, all Christians, whether in heaven or on earth, are regarded as saints. According to the scriptures, a saint is not someone who has gone and done wonderful, miraculous things, or one who has been deemed a saint by the church or by some organization. Saints are those who belong to the body of Christ, who are saved by grace through faith. The Greek word is hagios, H-A-G-I-O-S, meaning sacred or consecrated or holy. But really, a saint is another word for a Christian, simply a believer in Jesus Christ. And so we are, in that regard, saints, fellow saints in Christ Jesus. You probably read about saints in scriptures as Paul begins many of his letters, the Apostle Paul begins many of his letters addressing the believers as saints. And so a saint is a believer. And a saint is both a sinner and a saint. All human beings are sinners, but not all human beings are saints. But as we confess our need for Jesus Christ and accept his sacrifice for us on the cross, and we trust in him as our Savior, and we become a believer, we are also a saint, synonymous saint and believer, saint and Christian, according to God's word. Now, we're not sinless, as 1 John 1:8 reminds us. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. So we're not associating saints with being sinless, certainly, but we live our lives as saints, as ones who have trusted in Jesus Christ, and now we seek to live our life for him as Christ is in our lives. Saints have been saints are those who have been blessed by God and called his children by faith. We are his children. Again, we're not saints because the church declares it so or because we somehow attain that, but we are saved by grace through faith as a gift of God, trusting in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. So hopefully at this point you understand saint. When we talk about saint, we're also talking about a believer or a Christian. That being said, of course, some have accepted a wrong understanding of what a saint is. Again, the biblical description of a saint is really spoken contrary to some of the teachings, of course, of the Roman Catholic Church and their understanding of saints, who revere the saints, seeing them perhaps as superior. You may or may not know that their theology, that they consider saints are those who are gone to heaven. In the Bible, saints are either those believers who have gone ahead of us into heaven, or those saints are also us who are yet here on this earth. In Roman Catholic theology, a person doesn't become a saint unless he or she is beatified or canonized by the Pope or by the bishop. But in the scriptures, all who have received Christ by faith are considered to be saints. In Roman Catholic theology, saints are revered to and prayed to, and in some instances are even worshiped. In the scriptures, on the other hand, saints are called to worship and pray to God only. And so the biblical definition is what is important, and of course that is what we're referring to today when we talk about the word saints. Well, anyway, when we think about those who are faithful to the Lord, we remember those who have lived before us and have been faithful, and they're living out their faith for the Lord. And in Hebrews chapter 11, We often consider that scripture to be what we call the faith chapter in the scriptures, which gives us a wonderful list of believers, of saints of the past. For example, one of the faith giants we think of that lived 2,000 years before Jesus was a man by the name of Abraham, called by God, we're told in the scriptures from Hebrews 11. Abraham called by God to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, and he obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did his son Isaac and grandson Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. Again, we read about that from Hebrews 11, verses 8 through 10. Well, we might ask, well, what was the most important aspect of Abraham's faithfulness? I believe it is this. Abraham believed God. Abraham believed God. He didn't question God. Although he didn't know what God had fully in mind, he believed the covenant that God had made with him. In obedience to God, he was willing even to sacrifice his very own son Isaac, who God had promised to him as his son. And though none of them, of course, at that time had known Jesus, who came 2,000 years later upon this earth, yet they had the forward expectation of a Messiah to come and believed in the promise of God that was given to them. Abraham was not the only one who believed and obeyed, of course. Hebrews 11, as I mentioned, is full of those who have responded to God's call and trusted God. It mentions names such as Abel and Enoch, Noah and Moses and others. Giants, we might call, of the faith, saints, but it mentions something very interesting about these people in Hebrews 11. And I want to share from Hebrews 11, beginning at verse 13, which says this, as it refers to all the various ones, the names that I mentioned and others. It says this, Hebrews 11, 13 through 16. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. And they admitted that they were aliens and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they are looking for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Hebrews 11, 13 through 16. What they had in common is they knew God had a place far greater for them, that these people who lived by faith on this earth died without receiving all that God had promised while upon this earth. But they never lost their vision of what is called a better country. And that, of course, better country was and is heaven. They were looking for something and longing for something greater than they were experiencing. How about you and me? Are we longing for a better place? Are we longing for our heavenly home that God has promised to those who love him? Many of us occasionally become frustrated and even defeated when our needs and our wants and our expectations and our demands are not immediately met. We can become impatient, we can question God, and perhaps even get to a point of even wanting to give up altogether. It can become easy to lose sight for us of the bigger picture that God has in mind for us, and that, of course, is our heavenly home. In his book, Ken Davis, in the book Fire Up for Life, which he wrote several years ago, he tells the story of his friend whose name was Dave Veerman, who had been training to run a marathon race. Marathon is a long race, 26 miles long. And as Dave was training and the day came for the race, he thought he was in good shape. He was ready for the race. But during that race, there was a strong wind blowing directly against all the runners. And at mile marker 15, he was spent. He was exhausted. He had nothing left, and yet he had 11 miles to go. Every part of his body hurt, and his morale was low. He felt like he had blown a blowout in his running shoes, and he was just having to do all he could to make it step after step. And yet he pursued. He stumbled on. Every step, a major effort for him. Finally, he could hear the cheers of the crowd as he got near the finish line, knowing that he was close to achieving the goal that he had set for himself. And he saw his family there, his wife standing in the roadway, actually recording his finish. And Dave said, suddenly, he said, as I saw them, I felt a huge rush of adrenaline, and I was about 100 yards left to go to the finish line when I suddenly straightened up and sprinted the rest of the way to the finish line. Well, after Dave and his family got home, they sat down to watch the video that Dave's wife had taken of his finish. And what Dave saw was a man who was dragging himself across the finish line. To his surprise, the sprint that he thought he had done to the finish line was not a sprint at all. The video revealed no change in his posture, no change in his speed, just finishing the race. That rush of adrenaline, that burst of speed had only taken place not in Dave's body, but in his mind. Well, that being said, we are all running a race. We're all involved in life's marathon. It's not a sprint. It's a step-by-step race. The older we get, it seems, the finish line obviously gets closer, but we seem to slow down a bit. Sometimes things go along smoothly, and at other times, there is a circumstance that can really exhaust us in our lives, physically, emotionally, spiritually. We have challenges, we have responsibilities that seem to, at times, drag us down. And we may feel like our running shoes have blown out, just as Dave felt. It becomes difficult for us to move on, to keep going. Isn't it true? At that point, we need the encouragement. We need someone to cheer us on, to encourage us to finish. And Hebrews 12 gives us the encouragement for us spiritually as we go toward the finish line, the goal that God has prepared for us. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2 says this, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily hinders our progress, and let us run with endurance the race," or the marathon, if you could put it that way, "the race that God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes focused on Jesus, on whom our faith depends from start to finish. He, Jesus, was willing to die a shameful death on the cross because of the joy he knew would be his afterward." Again, that from Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Great joy in finishing the race. We can live in communion with God and run the race that he has set before us with endurance. As this scripture talks about developing at least three qualities that we see in our lives mentioned here in Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. And I briefly want to share those three with you. First of all, is the quality and the sensitivity to sin in our lives. It says this, again, from Hebrews 12, 1. "Let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily hinders our progress." Hebrews 12, 1. Here we have a picture of a runner ridding themselves of any excess clothing or baggage that would slow them down. For example, it would be foolish for a marathon runner to run with winter clothes and hanging on to a bunch of sacks and bags, unless maybe you're running a marathon in the Arctic, then you might enjoy the extra clothes, but usually you strip off anything that is unnecessary in order to run the race. Likewise, for us, it is foolish spiritually as saints of God to run the race that God has set before us, weighed down by things that he mentions, such as sin and guilt and shame and doubt and despair. For we know that separates us from God, the perfecter of our faith, cuts us off from his source. And until and unless we begin to experience the victory of stripping off those things that are hindering us, the sins that so easily entangle us, we will not be able to run the race as we ought to. We will have very great struggles. But Romans 8 verse 1 is a verse of encouragement for us, which says this: there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. No condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Romans 8:1. Getting rid of sins that slow us down, confessing them, receiving the forgiveness of God in Christ, who has declared us not guilty, he has offered us that freedom from that power and that strain that may be upon us, given the power to do his will and to be obedient to him. But if we hang on to those sins, we will have a much difficult time in doing in running the race that God has set before us. So we need a sensitivity to sin. One of the consequences, if we hang on, is that we give the enemy, the devil, an open door to attack us and to create some doubt in our lives. There's a story of a preacher from the early 1900s who told the story of when he was 12 years old and living on the farm. He had killed one of the family geese that they had there on the farm as he threw a stone and hit this goose squarely on its head, and it died. And thinking that his parents wouldn't notice that one of the 24 geese were gone, he buried that goose. But that evening, his sister took him aside and said to him, "I saw what you did. I saw what you did. If you don't wash the dishes for me tonight, I'll tell." The next morning, she gave the same warning to her brother, that if he didn't wash the dishes, she would tattle on him all that day. The next day, the boy felt duty-bound to do the dishes for fear of being found out that he had killed the family goose. And this went on for several days, he said. Finally, he could stand it no longer. He went to his mother and he confessed what he had done, and his mother responded to him. She said, "I knew all along what you had done. I was just watching from the kitchen window when it happened. I wanted to see how long you were going to allow your sister to blackmail you." Well, too often we are held hostage by deceitfulness in our hearts and lies from the devil. For God knows we cannot hide our sin from him. He knows what's going on, even though we may try to hide it from him. God has a better eyesight than any of us, including our mothers. And as the Holy Spirit shows us our sin and our need for forgiveness, we need to respond as we confess it to God, repent, and trust in God instead of trying to cover up or ignore what the Holy Spirit has revealed to us. And in that process, of course, back to what we mentioned, we can develop that sensitivity, that responsiveness that we need in our hearts to sin in our lives. Well, the second quality we can develop, as according to Hebrews 12, is to have a focus on Jesus, a preoccupation with Jesus. Hebrews 12:2 says we are to keep our eyes fixed upon Jesus, the author and defender of our faith. To get rid of the distractions that occasionally, and perhaps more than occasionally, often come upon us, that takes some perseverance and some focus. One example of that, of course, a biblical example that comes to mind probably for all of us, is the Apostle Peter, as he and the disciples were out crossing the Sea of Galilee in their boat, and a fierce storm, we're told, came up. And they were there out in the middle of the sea, and their boat was in trouble, they were in trouble, and Jesus, we're told, of course, came to them walking on the water, and they were terrified, thinking that they had seen a ghost. The raging storm, they didn't know what was going on, and Jesus, of course, first tells them, do not be afraid. And then he invites Peter to come to him, to walk to him. Peter gets out of the boat, trusting in Jesus, starts walking on the water. But as he sees the winds and the waves around him and all that's happening, the circumstances surrounding him, he begins to sink. As long as he focused on Jesus, he seemed to be fine. But when he began to take his eyes off Jesus and look upon the circumstances around him, he began to sink. He was in trouble. And he cried out to Jesus, which he ought to do, and Jesus rescued him. Well, before we get to that point where we need to cry out and be rescued, although that happens often, we need to remember what the scripture says, to focus our time and our energy upon that which brings us closer to him, closer to Jesus Christ, whether that be through worship or prayer or study of God's word or confession of our sin, being obedient to him, having fellowship with one another. We need the support and the encouragement of our fellow saints. We are not meant to do it all by ourselves. Focus on Jesus and upon his fellowship and our fellowship with one another is very important. The third thing we want to mention, and the last thing, the third quality to develop, we're told, is to develop an attitude of surrender, of submitting ourselves to Jesus Christ. We know that Jesus was willing to die a shameful death on the cross, but it says because of the joy set before him, he endured the cross. He submitted himself to the Father's will, not to that which he himself would have hoped. He has submitted his will to the Lord. It says this, who for the joy set before him, Jesus, endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Hebrews 12, verse 2, the second half of the verse. That's what Jesus did. He had joy. What was the joy? He knew the result of his sacrifice. He knew the result of him being obedient and submitting himself to the will of the Father. For Jesus came not to do his will, but the Father's will. Is that our attitude? Well, we pray it. In the Lord's Prayer, we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. So we pray the same prayer that Jesus prayed just before he died. The question is, do we mean it? It is a costly thing to pray that prayer. Not my will, but thine be done. But if we do, the reward is outstanding. If we do so, it will mean surrender every day of our life to the authority and control of Jesus, the world, the devil, and our flesh fights against that. We want to be in charge. We want to control our relationships, our finances, our activities, because we know, or we think we know, what's best for us. But where is the Lord in all that? It is God who sets the rules for the race of life, not us. He has a right to interrupt our lives no matter when, especially when we lose focus. Remember these words of Jesus. If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. For what good is it for a man to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his very soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? If anyone is ashamed of me, Jesus says, and my words, in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory with his holy angels. That from Mark chapter 8. I'll go back to the beginning. Good morning, saints. And in running your marathon and running your race, remember to throw off those sins that weigh you down. Keep your focus on Jesus, not on the difficult circumstances and trials that come your way. Surrender, thirdly, to the will of God and allow him to lead, to guide you day by day so that his purposes will be carried out in your life, in and through your life. And when you are finished with all of that, it gets even better. The result, of course, is a better country, as the scripture said, a better place that God has prepared for all his saints who trust in him. Glory to God. Let us pray. Lord, may our desire be your desire for us. May our will be your will. May your will be our will. Keep us focused on your plan for us. Help us to continue to follow you. Lead us and strengthen us so that as we finish the race with joy, we will know, Lord, that you have been with us and you have blessed us and you have, Lord, looked upon us with your grace and favor. Thank you, Lord, for these wonderful things that you promised for us. May we, Lord, be willing to listen and to follow you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please join me in confessing our faith as we recite the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The spark. sun.